Welcome to Bring Your Own Ball, the first of 2014, right here on FCUM TV, the Tinker Web channel dedicated solely to FC United of Manchester and the Cuban Tourist Board. On this show, we will demonstrate just what the Gig Lane pitch will look like as a working farm. We'll be giving some zero harm tips on how to stay fluorescent for even longer in a North Manchester building site. And we'll also discuss the quantum theory behind the long ball game and its possible benefits in combating the ongoing effects of climate change. Oh, and a special guest. Sound good? Hello there, highlights from the matches against Ilkeston and Trafford to come. First up, we have got a treat for you. Following last month's interview with El Presidente, an interview so focused on the role of Andy Walsh that many confused it for the South Bank show, the producers here at Bring Your Own Ball, for they do exist, pulled out all the stops to top it. And while calls to David May's people were sadly not returned, the call to our next guest was... Indeed, he answered the phone himself, which is the showbiz equivalent to having gravy on everything. Please welcome the FC United manager, Mr. Karl Marginson. Welcome to the amazing new sofa of truth. Let's start with the obvious stuff. This division is a right bugger to get out of, isn't it?
Just a few, mate. Just a few. It is when you're probably battling against budgets and other things like that. So yeah, it's a strange one. You know, we've got players with us now who've won the Conference North and they can't believe how difficult it is to get out. And I think that's added to as well by the FC United factor. You know, people always trying that little bit harder to put one over on you, because as we spoke to different players who played against us, the first fixture that they look for at the start of the season is when we're going to be playing FC. So, you know, that's one of them things that we have to combat and try and produce it week in, week out, whereas they can just do it on a one-off.
Yeah, you don't want to say cup final, but I know what you mean. When you're looking at that table now, who are you expecting to go right? Well, realistically, do you have to target the playoffs again? And are you looking at top spot for? Do you think like Skemmer there now? But then they play 30 games. You know, Chorley one behind, three games in hand, and all that.
I think it's that point. I think we just got to look at ourselves and make sure that, you know, we get to a consistent level. I think that's been our undoing of late. Consistency, and then obviously matches getting postponed, which doesn't help when you're looking to get a run of form going. Charlie obviously are in a very strong position, but they've not had a blip yet, and nine times out of ten in this league, and it doesn't matter who you are, there will be a point where you'll have a blip, and it's how you react to that.
Whereas you're, you know, used to coming good towards the end of the season.
Yeah, I mean, I'd love to know why. It's certainly not planned that way.
Yeah, do that Sheffield United thing of having the Christmas party in August.
You know, it must be something that we do, and as the season builds on, then, you know, we do seem to come good, and hopefully that's going to, you know, be the same thing this year and get us up there. And you never know what's going to happen. There's still a long, long way to go in this season, and there'll be teams, I mean, draws, and have started pulling in players and started paying money. So, you know, teams like that will start taking points off people. And like I say, it's how you react to disappointments then.
A lot of teams in your position would think the playoffs are going to be a tough shout, whereas at FC it's expected.
It might be expected by quite a few people. I know how hard it is to get there. You know, it is something, you know, because we've done so well over the past few years, people do look at us and say, well, FC will be in the playoffs, or if not, going up automatically. You know, all the hard work needs to be done week in, week out, you know, and that's something that, really boring old cliche, but you do, you've got to take it every game as it comes.
Let's, before we move on to the phrase one game at a time, let's get on to formation, because I remember being in the Central Methodist Hall in 2005, and one of the things when you were introduced that got the biggest cheer was you said we're going to play 4-4-2. Now, your top managers, your Mancinis, your Martinezes, your Marginsons have been experimenting with this one up top. Now, what are people saying to you about it? Are you bothered, and what's the thinking?
Am I bothered what people say about it? No. The thinking is to play attractive football, and that is possession based, whilst also, you know, making sure that we don't concede. It might look like it's one up top when it's not going too well. It's certainly not supposed to be like that. I think I like to think of it, if when we've got possession, it's 3-7. So you've got your two centre halves, your holding midfielder, your two full backs are pushed on. So in essence, it's 3-7. When we haven't got the ball, it should be 11. You know, that's as simple as I can put it. You know, it's something that we were doing well, and the loss of players that we've had in that respect, the likes of Ollie Banks, big players for us in a system like that, where he was allowed to have the space to go and get on the ball and make things happen.
Running the game, really.
Yeah, exactly. You know, you need players of a certain quality to play that type of system, formation, whatever you like to call it. So that's been a disruptive part of it, but I think we get in there, and I think we're not too far off. And it, you know, we've got the personnel within the squad who can interchange position and play in different areas of the field, you know, so that's something we try and do as well.
Meant though, you've had to leave out strikers, you've had to give some bad news. Just, I mean, in your case, it's a good job you're a big lad, really. You've had to leave Mike Norton out, and I don't think I'd fancy that task.
Well, he's been sent off twice, you know, so I mean, sometimes them decisions are taken out of your hands. Mm. But, you know, if there's one thing that I am with all the players, whoever they are, it's honest, you know, and there's reasons for doing things. And them reasons will be for the good of the team and no one else.
And it's good competition as well, and that's proven if they're coming off the bench and scoring, you know, if you're interchanging, for example, Greaves and Norton, and that's happened, hasn't it?
Yeah, you know, and that's a healthy competition that you need within the squad. You know, even at training, they'll be at training now, and when I get there, I'll go, and you'll be able to see the intensity is there because everybody wants to be starting on Saturday.
What about recruitment? I mean, when this FC was first started up, you could see how many people wanted to just come and play. Mm. And then there's this perception outside that FC have got loads of money that's just not matched by the reality. How hard is it, or how easy is it to recruit players?
I wouldn't say it's easy.
They must want to play for the fact that, you know, it's completely different from the other experience.
I think it depends where you're pitching in at and what kind of players you're looking for. Obviously, players from a lower level or even at our level, and some clubs to a certain extent in Conference North, they would want to come and play for FC. But if you look higher than that, in the Conference, say, for instance, there's not many lads who want to be dropping down. And, you know, that's, to be honest, that's where I think quite a few of our lads could be going and playing.
And that's about two-thirds professional anyway, isn't it?
Yeah, you know, you look at what we've got in the squad. I mean, John Wersnop, he's now playing at Alfreton Town in the Conference. Obviously, Ollie Banks moved on to Chesterfield. You know, so it's replacing them with the right kind of quality, and the right kind of quality costs.
What's going to change in your job, Margie, when you move to Moston? What is it going to be, easier, harder? I can't imagine it'd be harder in any way, but what's...
No, I would imagine it'd be the same. The workload and what we're trying to do is the most exciting thing, really. You know, the football side of it is great. It really is great. But what we can do at Moston, community-wise, you know, the academy setup that we want to put in place to start producing our own, you know, we've had sort of a few success stories, but we can really focus down on that. At the moment, it's quite difficult being in charge of them young players, only seeing them two nights a week, whereas you would if we're with them day in, day out, and we've got a scholarship program running it from the ground, you know, that's going to be more fruitful in the long run.
Well, everything's in one place as well, in terms of the admin on your day job as well.
Yeah, all that kind of stuff. And I was joking with somebody the other week because I'd had to tell somebody a bit of bad news, but We had to take them down the corridor in Gig Lane rather than having a little office to call somebody into. You just little things like that I'll add to it, you know. At the moment, this moment in time, I get to the ground and I just mill around. You know,
yeah.
There's nowhere for me to go and sit, so I'll go and have a chat with different people, which, you know, I really enjoy. But if I've actually got somewhere where I can go and we can set plans out that like we will do at training tonight, there'll be plans ready for Saturday. If I've got an office where we as a coaching staff we can get together and get the messages out there better.
Yeah, and you've got to have somewhere to keep the red wine, haven't you, for when Mourinho comes and some of those blue DVDs for if you get me a Warner tipping up. And there's going to be a floating pitch as well.
Yeah, apparently so. I haven't got a clue what it is. I was looking. We played a college game in the middle of that thing next to the city's ground, and that looks as though it's got a floating pitch, if I'm not mistaken. Because if there was wood around the outside of it, and then if you look down behind from where the wood is, you can see like there seems to be some kind of lake-ish. You know, so I'm assuming that's what it is. And by the looks of it, on that day it was absolutely howling down, and you know, the pitch was perfect, and obviously that's the most important thing from my point of view and the players' point of view.
Then finally, if anything, what are you going to miss from Gig Lane?
The people. The people who work there have been fantastic. That, you know, that's a little joke there, but the people who work behind the bars, can have the crap with the groundsmen. I always have a good bit of banter with and stuff. So you know, the people that we have contact with there at Bury have been absolutely magnificent with us.
I'll pass that on to Gordon Sawfleet at Bury, and Peanut and the General, the stadium announcer, is going to be very upset at that answer. Thanks a lot, managers. Brilliant. Very shortly, we will be discussing games of football with our usual panel of confirmed experts. Before that, the small matter of that floating football pitch in Moston to get our heads around. While many of you people out there in internet land have been viewing still images of massive mounds of mud, we sent our high-vis correspondent, Dr. K, with a cameraman to the site of FC United's new ground in Moston this past week to see, with the aid of moving frames, just what mud actually looks like when it's being shifted by a digger. Here's K.
And behind me, work's going on, as you can see, shifting bits of soil and bits of stones to make a big road, I think. It all looks very, very busy, but it's been raining a lot, so it's quite difficult for them to work, I think. We need to get some equipment before we can go further on the site. We need to get some steel toe cap boots and a hard hat and a high-vis vest, and then we'll be able to take more detailed photos of what's going on.
Yeah, my name's Andy Pilling.
And what's your job?
My job is to project manage the FC United project from concept to completion.
Right, okay. Yeah. So what does that involve
exactly? That involves basically everything before we start on site and when we've got on site to completion, health and safety, design team meetings, running the team, keeping the job on programme, managing the client. Basically everything comes through my door as a project manager. That's my responsibility.
Okay, I mean, and it looks really busy, so how's it going so far?
We're on programme, despite starting in the winter months. Worst time you could start a cut and fill exercise in the winter months, but we're managing to maintain programme at the moment. You can see it's rained all weekend, it's wet, but we're finding the right methods to do the job, and we're keeping it on track.
So, are there special things you have to do in the winter to keep going?
Well, we basically just need to pray for a bit of fine weather as a starter, and as we get the wet weather, we need to manage the construction around that. It's rained a lot, so we're finding catchment pools on the site to pump water from A to B. Just keep the floor trades going, really. It's manageable, but you've got to have your finger on the pulse.
What's going on behind us at the moment?
What's going on today? We've just got the first one of the two piling contractors on site. So we've got the vibro piling going on, which is to stiffen the ground up, ready for the foundations. Just got the wagons coming in with the stone, ready to start compacting the ground. Wednesday this week we have the second piling contract comes on there. They're in the Orgard piling around the contamination area, so they'll be like the ground will be suspended in that area. But there are two trays we can do in the wet weather, so we're lucky at the moment.
Okay. Yeah. How big is the contamination area?
Contamination area is roughly, well, I'm going to say between 70 and 100 square metres.
Right, okay. It's quite big.
Cube, yeah. Take out and take away, yeah. But we're at the end of that now.
You have to take all of that out?
Yeah, we've got to take it out. We've got to drain the old pond away first, and then we take the contamination away. It's actually reduced from what we originally thought. So that's a little bit of a win for the project, but we finally got rid of it.
Great. And behind me, it looks like a sea of mud, but it's actually where we were a couple of weeks ago when we did the reconstruction with John O'Shea and Neville Gaby of where the goal mouth and the terrace was going to be when we did the reconstruction where all the fans stood on chairs and stuff.
Do you support a football team?
I do. I support Manchester United.
Right,
in my sins, all my life. So, but you know, in the background, FC United could be my second team.
Very diplomatic.
Yes.
Thank you. January, and it's about 4 weeks since we were here last time, and to the untrained eye, I think what you can say is the word that sums it up is mud. It's been raining a lot. The site is really, really muddy. We've just watched while one digger moved a load of stone just for another lorry to be able to deliver something, and I think that's what it's like at the moment. We've got our hard hats, our steel toe cap boots and our high-vis jackets, so we're all ready to roll. But unfortunately, we can't really get very far. The only bit we can go is along here because it's just too muddy. Just behind me, you can see, it's quite exciting, the shape of the football pitch has actually been cut out. That is this oblong here, just behind me, the paler colour soil. So that's pretty good. So you can actually see something starting to take shape. And just to my left here, what you can see is some big screw-like things have arrived, massive screws, which are called augers. And they've put the piles down, which is big things of concrete, and they're setting about doing the drainage for the south stand. That's what's going on just to the left of me. And I guess where we're standing is going to be the west stand. That over there is the east. South and north. I don't know exactly what they're going to be called, but that's the positions of them. So yeah, quite exciting really. The guy over there is the site manager and he seems to be doing something to do with measuring out where the pitch is actually going to be. I guess I have to get it exactly right to begin with, or it doesn't work out in the end.
Chris Jordan, site manager here at FC United.
Right, okay.
The Rangers.
So how's it going?
It's going really well now, and hopefully the weather keeps up, we're going to make a lot more progression, because we've had some real bad weather and obviously it's hard working in them conditions, but hopefully now we've broke its back and
it looks we're going incredibly to get on with it now. Muddy to me,
To the untrained eye, it's worse. Looks worse than it actually is, because we've got a lot of the hard stands in the distance there, and that's where all the work's being done really. It's just the in and out, what it's cosmetically bad.
Right, okay. So that's been made more solid, has it?
Where the foundations are going, oh, that's got a piling mat, which is fit for these big heavy machines, so they don't sink in it and things like that.
Right,
it's
okay.
Been, you know, it's a, It's a load bearing.
Right,
so
okay.
This is that, yeah.
Okay, because we just watched somebody move a load of sort of hard rubbly stuff in order to then put the lorry to go along it. It looked like really complicated. Just to move, just, it looks hard.
Well, it is, yeah. And under this road here, there's a hard surface, and that's just the surface content.
Yeah.
So we scrape that off and replace the hard stuff and just keep the wagons rolling as it is.
And pray for it to stop raining.
And pray for the rain to stop. Combat it. It's winter, you know, you're going to get this, and you've got to work with it really as much as you can.
Yeah, sure. Now, we just watched you over there doing something that looked like you were measuring something really carefully.
Yeah,
and putting...
I was doing the a final survey on the, that's going to be obviously the pitch.
Yeah.
So we're just doing a survey just to find the levels, what we're at the minute, before we do the final cut off and get the pitch at its final level, really. So we just need to know where we're at the minute and how far off we're. Need to be to work out how many tons going to come off there yet, you know.
Right, okay. This is the level height wise.
Yeah, it's just an existing level. That's all we're doing. We're just seeing what level we're actually still there at the minute and where we need to get it down to. So we'll do some calculations and come back with some figures and just to get the final picture.
It's going to be a special type of pitch, isn't it? A suspended water table pitch or something?
It's,
is that the right word?
It's what all, you know. People in this, obviously, the top premiership to do their own way, but as far as economy, it's going to have like a 100 mil sand on top of it, then there's a subsoil which then the roots get down to, and it's like a, it's not the expensivest way of doing it, but it's a great way of draining and keeping a good pitch.
Right.
You know, and it's hopefully it'll set them off and it'll be a great pitch for years to come now with them like that, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, so try to avoid waterlogging, basically.
Yeah, it is, it's going to be all drained, but obviously it's got the new grasses to come on it, so what they do is put a sand base just under that turf and that helps to get the drainage through.
Right, okay.
The roots reconnect through that gap to the soil and
okay, so it's like an extra layer of
drainage basically. Yeah,
right.
So,
very interesting actually, you know, to find out about it when you don't know.
Yeah, it is.
So are you a football fan? Do you support?
I follow Burnley when I can.
Burnley, right,
when
okay.
Yeah.
Is that, you're from Burnley?
I am, that area, yeah.
Okay.
So you've got to support the locals. Just,
great.
But I might be a supporter of FC United when we get up and running.
Yeah, well, you have to come and have a watch of a game,
I'll definitely
won't you?
Have to
once
come
you build the stadium.
Of course I will, yeah.
Great, thank you.
Kay there from Muddy Moston. So, football. This month I am joined once again in the studio by FCUM Radio's Pingu and returning to the SETI of truth. Please welcome back one half of the TV commentary team, Roy Williamson. Look very comfortable, lads. Roy's brought his piece of paper to remind him what happened in his current life. But first up, a high-scoring affair from earlier in the month of January as FC United travelled to Ilkeston FC in a match that passed a pitch inspection by a margin so narrow that it doesn't even fit on this... Oh, I see, it's a joke. With all the goals, here's the radio
touchline
team featuring...
A rare joke for Brownhill to set the ball, but he slips and then he forced favour with Alfred Byrne. Byrne lets the ball roll across him, plays the ball up now towards Matthew Wolford, and Wolford, the first touch is superb.
Oh,
what a, it should be an opportunity, it should be a goal. Oh, what a well-worked goal. Absolutely superb from FC United of Manchester. The fans on the far side of the ground cheering with some aplomb there, but wonderful football. Lovely play again by Elkins into the penalty area again. This time it goes across. Should be a goal, and it is indeed. Poor defending from FC United, but it was well played, I have to say, by, I think it was the number nine there, was it? Gary Ricketts, who got past Brownhill there, nutmegged him, put the ball in. It was pulled the ball back like he should, and a back heel from 7 yards out. A tricky, good quality finish there by James Reid. FC United's goalkeeper clears the line high in the air. The ball goes this time. Just about makes the halfway line. Up goes Daniels to try and win it. Brings it down well. And then he has another opportunity now. Outside the penalty area, he'll have a shot at goal. Smash the ball. Here's an opportunity. It's a goal! And this time they're looking across the line. He was no offside, giving Tom Greaves there. Well, it was all the work in fairness of Greg Daniels. He held the ball superbly well. Played it straight through the middle. Tom Greaves... Left-hand side, ball to the penalty, FC United, it's a decent ball towards the back post, evades the goalkeeper, it's forced nicely, it should be an equalising goal, and it is exactly that, Again, FC United going to sleep at the back. The goalkeeper, well, it was first and foremost, Ryan Wilson made a good move down the left-hand side, flying the ball in. FC United's goalkeeper, when he got a fingertip for it, he palmed it straight into the path of the opening goal scorer, James Reid. This afternoon, or early evening now, is FC leave two men up, three men back defending them. And Reid, they're left-footed, he'll flight this ball. It's a decent ball towards the back post. Up goes the skipper, heads a golf ball forward. Keeper gets a punch on it, it's an opportunity, should be a goal. It is indeed, and again, a goalkeeping error. It has to be said, he came for a ball that he was never going to get. He palmed it about 2 yards out. The skipper from 15 yards absolutely leathers it to the top corner. Joe Maguire with a captain's goal there. It falls nicely. It was a great finish. A tremendous finish, though, by Joe Maguire, the skipper, centre-half, scoring like he was Ruud van Nistelrooy of Ilkeston. As Davis now, well, he got over the halfway line with some ease and some comfort there, but there was no one really to help him. But now Daniels will take over outside the penalty area. Daniels will have a shot on goal. No, he plays the ball inside. It's an opportunity. Should make it 3-0. It is! It's 3-0! FC United substitute again! It's 3-0 FC United. The ball was played through. It's 3 apiece here. And can you believe it? For all the possession and all the quality that they've had all for the majority of this game, FC United again been thrown a lifeline.
Well, Swampy, what a ding-dong-do.
Ding-dong-do. It was indeed, yes. It was nice that the game went ahead first and foremost. The pitch, in fact, was absolutely fantastic. You know, there was not a problem at all with the pitch. And, you know, six goals, really entertaining game, in all fairness. And I think FC probably went home happy with the point in reality.
Well, if you equalise that late on, I suppose you're going to be. But after going ahead twice...
Yeah, I mean the first goal with Daniels, the link-up play between the three or four players there was fantastic.
Oh, Daniels, we were all thinking, that's magic. It was that good.
Can we leave now, please? I can't work with this. This is absolutely ridiculous. Yes, Debbie, it was indeed. It was a superb goal and taking the lead. I mean, it was one of those games we started off well and then we fell back into that trap of letting the sucking up a little bit of pressure too deep. But we get the goal against the run of play. And I mean, I said in commentary that I thought really that they'd be very, very disappointed to be going in at half-time 1-0 down because they had a number of chances, really, and perhaps should have been in front prior to us taking that 1-0 lead.
Two goals from the sub, Tom Greaves. A brace, and the word brace is not used often enough, Swampy.
Well, it is if you score two goals. It'll be used quite a lot, I would have thought, but...
Do you use it on the radio?
I always use it, yeah, certainly, yes. And many a schoolboy and schoolgirl from about the age of 12 to 16 probably use the word brace quite a lot.
Excellent.
Two great goals. Tom Greaves is a top quality player, scored over 20 goals this season now for FC United, and a lot from the bench. You know, he's not figured every single week, and for me, he's got to be right up there with player of the season because his work rate is terrific and he's a top quality player, but off the pitch he's a wonderful lad as well. Very very grounded, really nice individual, works in sport himself, and you know, his rewards are there and he gets a chance. He very rarely misses the target, you know, and that's one of the benefits. He's good in the air, as we've seen all through the season, near post headers. But it was two quality goals that really saved the day for FC United.
I'll go to the shop for you, you don't want more than 10p. He can find things behind the fridge.
Yeah, I suppose he could, yeah.
He is the only member of the FC United squad who knows what USB stands for. There was also a debut for Dave Carnell, now fifth keeper FC have used.
Yeah, and it's probably a debut he'd like to forget, in all fairness. He was atrocious. Not throughout the whole game, but the parts of the game that mattered.
Just the bits where it was
needed. It was really needed. He was... there must have been nerves there for him, but you know, he's a Conference North player. He's done very well at Hyde. I was a little bit disappointed, but we put it down basically because we run a campaign for about three or four games to basically get him to tuck his shirt in. A scruffy goalkeeper doesn't do well, and it's no surprise.
I've heard everything now. Mourinho having to go to another manager for parking the bus,
yeah.
And now Swampy calling someone for being scruffy.
Yeah, well, I think it's a uniform. And you get on that football pitch, shirt tucked in, socks up, you know, no gloves, black boots, happy days. That's where you come from. We don't want the... I mean, he played in one game recently.
That's what Paolo Di Canio wants as a kit.
Does he? Do you think he wants black shirt? No,
black shirt. No gloves, perhaps on one hand.
Yeah. Well, the goalkeeper with the brown shirt, apparently, as well. But no, I mean, I like the uniform to look well. I mean, he played in one game, and I've got to say, I mean, you saw me last month as Pingu, and he basically turned up, he had yellow feet, he was happy feet. Although, he didn't necessarily play particularly well either. He's had a hard time. He'll get better, but you know, 7 goals conceded in 3 games says a lot for me. And
it's not all about him though, Swampy, is it? The defence hasn't been great, has it?
It's not, no, but I mean, against
Ilkeston, right.
But against Ilkeston, to be honest, there were fundamental errors and mistakes. I mean, he has made some terrific saves again when we played in other games, and we'll be talking about them, I'm sure, shortly. But you know, I don't want to do him a disservice because he is a good goalkeeper. You know, they brought him in, and you know, he'll get better and he'll improve certainly. But just asking on the Ilkeston game, I thought he was a little bit poor, and 2 goals were his fault.
Yeah. All right, well, I only mentioned him in passing because it was his debut, so I'm sorry, Dave, if you're watching. But we went on a bit longer than we were going to do.
Took your shirt, it will be fine.
We had no idea that Swampy had this obsession with you. I'll point that out now, but excellent Carnell knowledge.
Oh!
Hey! Yeah. Have you been listening to the radio commentary?
Yeah. What's up, man? At that point, the bar scarf stopped twirling for a couple of January weeks. A weird fixture anomaly meant that there were no scheduled FC games for 10 days. Can you imagine that? When they eventually returned, the boys in red were in the third round Dudeson Cup hot action.
Yes.
Travelling to NPL Division 1 North Club, Ossett Town. Lads, walk us through this one like a bad episode of Last of the Summer Wine.
Well, it was a good game, actually. It was a good game of football. Our crowd was decent. I thought quite a few of our people turned up, and I thought once they went in front, we got back into it. I thought we played really well. It was one of those games. There's a few games, isn't there, when there's not that many there, that turn out to be really enjoyable, and it was a good trip. And I thought we played well in the circumstances.
Yeah, it was.
And deserved to get through. I know they're a league below us, but you've still got to beat them, haven't you?
Well, they set off very, very quickly, fast and furious from the beginning, and you know, they really worked tirelessly hard, and they got the noses in front early doors. Mm. And you know, it was one of those games where you thought, well, we're in for a right battle here. The pitch was difficult. It was a cold, wet, miserable night, in all fairness. And we lose centre half very early in the game. Jerome comes on with a number 17 shirt on, plays at left back, superb. For the entire game,
and he was a cracking equaliser, wasn't it, by Rodri, and then he got himself sent off.
Yeah,
nobody was quite sure what actually happened in that melee just before the break.
I think he likes to think he was the peacemaker, but the peacemaker turned villain, unfortunately. And you know, he'll rue that, because you know, he wants to play in the Dukes and Trophy, he wants to play in cup competitions, yeah. He wants to play every week for FC United. But if he's getting himself sent off, and it was for violent conduct. But it was something of that nature. It'd be a 3-match ban for him, unfortunately. But
it was unfortunate that he was the only player that got sent off. Then number 4 should definitely have gone with him if he was going to send him off.
And in all fairness, melees need to happen on the halfway line, not going into a tunnel where you can't commentate on, because it's a travesty if you can't commentate on a great melee.
Or by the Stretford paddock against Arsenal in '89.
That wasn't a bad one for me. There was about 22 players there, wasn't it? Was it after a challenge on Chucky McClare?
Almost. McLeod and Winterburn.
That's right, yeah. It was the good old days where, you know, you could have a fight in a football match and no one would get sent off. Yeah. But nowadays you raise your hands or a little bit of that, and players are kidology active.
And no weaponry.
No. I mean, I like to see that, the likes of, you know, Gould's captain. You know, that's the kind of football that you want to see. You know.
So anyway, Charlie Raglan went off injured, but good to see Jerome right back. I mean, another substitute scorer.
Right, you what? He was left back, not right back.
You said left back.
Yeah, no, but you said nice to see Jerome right back.
Oh, excellent.
He was actually left back.
Oh, that's really good. You've got 3 points this week. Excellent. Norton came on, scored, a substitute scoring once again, but I suppose really only 275 in attendance. If you get past, I think, saying to Margie there just off camera that if it gets to semi-finals, that's when people are probably really going to start taking it seriously. But it'd be nice in the quarters, wouldn't it?
I think so, yeah. I mean, we're going down, you know, to Carlton, East Nottinghamshire on a Tuesday night. I'm sure there'll be thousands there.
There will be a few, go, I think.
It's a new ground, isn't it?
Yes,
it's a new
ground. And that's one of the things that stops people going these days, it seems, if they've been there 2 or 3 times. Before we leave that Ossett game as well, we must talk about Daniel's magic again, because the way he made that goal for Norton was superb, wasn't it? Round 2 or 3 on that right-hand side, overcame the ball, Norton put it in.
And what did he have on? Not a lot.
Well, he actually did, actually. And he had his shirt tucked in. Very, very professional. He's for me, player of the season at the moment.
Great.
Absolutely outstanding.
I don't know who our website man of the match was at Ossett. Dave Carnell.
Dave Carnell.
I'm on your side if you're watching, Dave. That doesn't mean accidentally punch me in the head, mistaken for a ball.
Just very quickly, let me point out what Dave Carnell did. Something I've never seen in football. He had the ball, he took it to the far left-hand side of his own 18-yard area, slowing the game down, then took it right across as a player encroached, right in front of the sticks. He did a basketball move between his legs with the ball, about half a yard from the goal line. He's got confidence, the lad. I'll give him that. It absolutely scared us to death commentating because, you know, to see a guy do that between his legs and then take the ball down to the right hand side. He reminds me very much of sort of like Barthez. He likes to do things with his feet, you know. He likes to play with the ball. He's a bit of a footballer, a bit of a showman, you know. And he is a good goalkeeper, don't get me wrong. So, he's tucked his shirt in now anyway. So
could we compromise by getting him to tuck his shirt in, but perhaps having a glitter belt?
It's a good idea. Yeah, I like that. Yeah, yeah.
All right. I'm up for that. Yeah, if it takes off, just bring the copyright here. So, a quarter final to come then. And what page are we on? Back to the league first there. Crucial match away at Whitby Town. Now, due to the Stoker Convention, and in particular the section that states that vampires don't do cameras, there is no footage of this match. FC unfortunately lost 3-2 in a very tight game in North Yorkshire. The next match, moving swiftly on, was on what scientists and historians all agree is the right side of the Pennines, despite it being on the left on my map. FC United hosted Trafford FC at Gig Lane with umbrellas at the ready were Roy Williamson and first Sam Hoddart.
Welcome to Gig Lane on this Tuesday night. FC host to Trafford FC. I'll just go through the Trafford side and then Roy can give you what Margie's picked this evening. In net for Trafford, Kieran O'Hara, number two. Clement Beadle, Luke Heron, Stephen Mason, Nayet Balau, Christopher Palmer, Shelton Fane, Martin Andrews, the captain, Michael Oates, Thomas Schofield, and Simon Haddadji. Very wet pitch at Gig Lane, Roy.
Cheers, Sam. Yeah, let's. Well, we're going to start the game. That's all we can finish it, eh? Right, in goals, Dave Carnell, number two, Liam Brownhill. Greg Daniels, number three, obviously won't play there. Dean Stock, captain four. Charlie Raglan and Tom Davis, the two central defenders again. Chris Worsley, Callum Byrne together in midfield, it's interesting. Mike Norton up front. Jerome Wright, number 10. I expect Jerome will play left back. And Nelson Motta gets another run out at number 11. Subs bench for FC tonight, Adam Jones, Matty Walwin, Ashley Mulholland, Joe Fox and Lee Neville. That was a great goal there from Callum Byrne, and Jerome picked him out there, ball came across, and a bit disheartened with that Trafford because that came from what, 30 yards out? Absolutely cracking shot, so Callum Byrne opens the scoring for FC tonight, and you've got to say FC United do need something early, don't they, Sam?
Let's pick these last shirts up, good ball that into the box. Knocked over from Dave Carnell. Free kick. Oh, that's a good free kick, that. Totally unmarked. I tell you what, we were asleep there because the number eight, I think it was, the captain, Martin Andrews, he just snuck in there completely unmarked. We stood like statues. When you talk about training ground goals, I think we would class that as one of them. Carnival. Near post. Good corner that. Very pass pace of football. That was a belting cross from Jerome, that right to the danger.
Good ball, that's another one. He's on, Jerome's in the box. Oh, Jerome misses it with his left foot. The goal was gaping. No offside. Oh, that was the moment, wasn't it? Time running out. Norton. Ooh, just wide. Well, they're going for it here. Oh, and the referee blows. Well, chances at the end there for FC, certainly, Sam. 2 points lost in terms of like playoff places, but you've got to say Trafford deserved that draw there tonight. Cracking goal started it with Callum Byrne, 30-yarder screamer, but defensive frailties again, just letting, I think it was Mason, wasn't it, who was, what, 2 yards out when he headed it in, absolutely unmarked, and FC fall, if you like, dropped 2 points to a side in mid-table, and, well, we've got to do a bit more, haven't we?
Yeah, we've certainly got to do a bit more. You're quite right saying Trafford deserved a point because they played really well in these conditions. And we tried to play football on the floor, to be fair, but it just wasn't good enough, was it? And if we've got any aspirations in the playoff place, well, we took another blow tonight, surely we.
So a great start then. 6 minutes in, Callum Byrne, one touch, bang, very me that.
Cracking goal, wasn't it? Absolutely superb goal. And I thought the game was, contrary to what my comrade's going to say in a minute, I thought the game was really good given the circumstances, because that really was a game that might not have started. It was absolutely dreadful, and how we got through it, I don't really know.
Did you fancy just going home?
Well, I think most people did, didn't they? But we managed to get through the game, and I thought Trafford played really well because I expected us to get 3 points there. I expected us to sort of get back on the winning streak, and to be fair, Trafford deserved the draw, I thought. But shocking defending for their goal when the guy's sort of like a yard behind our back four or whatever it was. Ball comes over and he heads it in, and you've got to look at it there. What's that? 3, 6, 7 goals in 3 games conceded, and if there's a problem with our team at the moment, I think that's where it is.
Yeah, I mean, the game itself, Carnell changed his shirt. He was wearing blue, tucked in, taking heed of what we'd been discussing. And the disappointment for me, really, in the game was, although the two teams attacked, and attacked with passion and with a little bit of quality, I mean, the goal, as you say, was a terrific strike by Byrne. And we've been discussing, saying, you know, one thing FC United don't do is shoot outside the box enough. And lo and behold, within 8 minutes, we'd done that, scored a goal.
Yeah.
But that was the only shot. There was nothing else really that we did. In horrendously bad conditions, you've got to test goalkeepers. And both Trafford were guilty of it, as FC were. And I'm thinking, you know, I mean, you could even put in free kicks where you can see there's a giant puddle 8 yards in front of the goalkeeper. Put it in there. Everyone can slide in, you know, the ball to the back of the net. And that was the football was good considering the conditions, I grant you that. I was just a little bit disappointed that there wasn't anything, no real clinicalness from either team. And in a game like that, goalkeepers need to come off covered in mud, as if they've been saving, you know, they've been diving left, right and centre. Both goalkeepers came off pretty much spotless, you know, and that was the downside for me. You've got to make goalkeepers working and test them in conditions like that.
You want them very, very smart at the start of games and absolutely
filthy at the end. Yeah, that's me.
You want them baseball groundish, don't you? You want them on a ploughed field, diving in mud. That's what you want, old style.
I want us to have shots on target, you know, and if they come off muddy, they come, you know, let's baseball.
Baseball ground.
Oh, the baseball ground. Yeah. Sorry, yeah, I'm sorry.
You're trying to sidetrack you on how you like your young men to look after a game.
I like before, during and after, in all fairness. I think there's nothing wrong with that.
You mentioned Steve Mason's equaliser there being completely unmarked and the defence maybe being a problem. But then Charlie Ragland having gone off injured previous game, you know, he's come back fit. Next game back.
Well, the defensive pairings that we've got, whether it's Ragland and Davis or Adam Jones came in and played, Ragland went off that game, didn't he? And Neville went in.
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
So I accept there's been some issues there, some problems with injuries, but I just don't think we look very, very sure at the back. And if you look at the three games, Ilkeston, Whitby and Trafford, we don't look an outstanding side compared to any of those three. And those are not the three best teams in our division. We look as though we're part of a kind of group of 8 or 9 teams.
Yeah, I would.
They're all pretty decent, but you know, your Chorley and Skem look to be a class above to me.
Well, Carl,
we don't look like that. We look like one of many, I think.
Karl did allude earlier in the show, didn't he, to the fact that, you know, a lot of teams want to go out there and beat FC United and Manchester. And, you know, that's something that is not a new phenomenon.
Yeah.
We've known that for years now. Yeah. So we've got to be able to do something with that. We are in that group, as you say, about eight or nine clubs that are all very, very similar. And, you know, the two teams, as I said at the beginning of the season, if whoever finishes above Chorley will probably win the league. You know, and I think those two teams, both Skem and Chorley, if they have a blip, but they're still that far away now. I think for us, it's the playoffs, but there's so many other teams in and around, and we are much of a muchness. I'd like to see us just, we play some good football, but a little bit more urgency, get into the final third a little bit quicker, and we've got to test goalkeepers a lot more, you know, because when we do, we score goals, you know, and we've got the attacking prowess. You know, we've got some good players. We've got Daniels, we've got Greaves, we've got Norton, we've got Wolfenden, you know, that can all score goals for you from deep, other players coming through. Let's see Byrne getting involved a little bit more, make a few more shots, because we've seen the quality of what he can do with the ball. But a quick mention, I thought the likes of Neville, since he's come back, I think he's had two very good games. Mm-hmm. I think he's done really, really well, putting into a different position, although he has played it in the past. But I thought he's done well. He's, you know, and he's again another good squad member. But the goal, you say, you're right. I mean, it was telegraphed because the free kick was there. We're all waiting for it, and we'd
done one 5 minutes before, hadn't they?
And it
was sipped over the bar. Yeah. So it was a rerun of that, really.
And it was a very, very poor goal to concede. And as I say, they thoroughly deserved the draw in a game that we should have really been looking at if we are serious contenders to get into those playoff positions. But I'm sure we'll play poorly and we'll win games between now and the end of the season, you know. So, you know, it's still a lot to play for, a lot of games to go.
For anyone who's still with us on the Christmas lectures, we should talk about Whitby. We didn't see any action there. It wasn't filmed. And another loss, but a good game.
Yeah, terrific game. You know, there was over 800 people there. I think about 500, 600 FC fans made the journey across to North Yorkshire. The pitch was difficult, it was heavy. The wind, as always, at North Ferry, at Whitby, plays its part. But I thought they're one of those teams that we talked about in and around, the same as FC United. We play some good football at times, but I think they out-muscled us, really. They played a bit more concise football. And even though I think we'll be disappointed, I mean, there was elementary mistakes for the first goal. Adam Jones reintroduced, you know, he got an equaliser for us, which was fantastic. But between him and a couple of defenders and the goalkeeper, it was just a little bit slow with that first goal, allowed them to get the noses in front, and then we get the equaliser. And it was one of those games, really, you know, either team could have possibly won it, and it was the home team that took the chances better than FC United. And they got probably just about a deserved 3 points.
They had that centre forward Armstrong, didn't they?
Yeah.
Who scored a couple. And although you mentioned about Greaves, who's done pretty well this year, but we haven't got somebody who's doing it as consistently well as that lad for them. And there's one or two other teams that have got sort of player that we're kind of a goal scorer, I'm talking about. We've got players who put the shift in.
I don't know. Greaves scored 20 goals. I mean, that's not bad for, you know, he's not playing week in, week out. I know he's been injured recently as well. And, again, it goes to the old adage, doesn't it? We were talking earlier on, and Karl was about, you know, the 4-4-2. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. You put the 4-5-1, as people think, but it's always a 4-3-3. You play with a bit more urgency, you get the ball up the field quickly with some good quality. And make goalkeepers work. I think that's really what FC United need to do.
Very astute supporters at Whitby as well, singing "You've only come for the chippy."
Yes,
absolutely, Bob.
Good. That's what I went for.
As if you could stomach it, there ought to have been two more games on this month's show. Alas, the rain caught us all by surprise once more. We just can't play football when it rains, can we? It's not the Middle Ages. Some clubs manage it, though. Here's Stafford Rangers at Grantham Town on the last weekend of January. This match lasted 90 seconds before the ref said, "That'll do, pig. That'll do." Picturesque scenes there in Lincolnshire, and I, for one, am now more likely to plan a holiday in a caravan there rather than having it carpet bombed for giving the world Margaret Thatcher. And now for a full roundup of everything else that's as happening as a 60s disco, here's Marv Willis.
Where?
Over there, by the beef burgers.
Hello,
and welcome to the Shindig Breakfast Kitchen. I'm Marv, and this morning we're going to be making the Evo Stick Premier League sandwich. Tasty. It's the perfect partner to this weekend's Chinese New Year celebrations, but there's no filly in this sandwich. That's a horse joke. There's currently a pack of around 20 teams who could still make the promotion battle, but let's not get ahead of ourselves. Let's start by having a look at the bottom of the league, as of Sunday the 2nd of February. Droylsden lie bottom of the table and look rather stale with just 2 points. Also in the relegation zone are Stafford, Stocksbridge and Witten. Witten are just 2 points ahead of 20th place Stamford in what looks like it'll be quite the meaty battle. Looks good, doesn't it? 9 points then separate the next 8 teams, all the way to Trafford in 12th, who are on 43 points. Matlock and Rushall are in 11th and 10th, and then FC sit in 9th with 48 points, a couple of games in hand over those ahead, and 5 points off the playoffs. Ahead of FC, Blyth, Whitby and King's Lynn sit ready to pounce on the playoffs. Represented here by 3 different cheeses. I'm using cheddar, port salut and brie, but really you can use whatever you like. More cheese? Yes, please. And so, into the playoffs. In 5th, Ashton United, 55 points. In 4th is Worksop Town, on 57 points. 3rd is AFC Fylde, also on 57 points. And 2nd is Skelmersdale United, sitting on 61. Top of the pile, Chorley currently sit proud as a peacock, but are just 2 points in the lead. So, with approximately 17 games to go for all sides this season, there's still plenty of bite to this butty. The Evo Stick Premier League sandwich doesn't look good, but tastes amazing. Back for studio.
Marv there. Anyway, enough of the men's side of things. Let's turn to the women's game now. Look how crowded the crouch is as our resident ladies' man, Neil Boothman, is back with his hair.
Hey-o!
Not much on-the-pitch action, Neil, for the women's team the past month. No. One match did beat the weather, though.
Yes.
Perhaps the biggest game of the season so far, then, wasn't it? Middleton Athletic. Top of the table clash, despite a crowd almost as big as the men's Dudeson Cup sports tie. Didn't go to plan. The way it went though, 3-0 down and then pulling 2 back. Do the girls come off sort of downhearted at being battered for most of that game, or take the positives out of the fact that they reacted well to being 3-0 down and got 2 back?
If I'd have been a player, I think I'd have been a bit downhearted because they only were dominant for the last 10 minutes. It wasn't really what they wanted to have took out the game. Joe O'Connell again scoring a hat-trick on the same ground. Got to stop playing there. I think that's what the league rules have got to say from now on.
There were some decent
performances. I mean, Chelsea patient in the defence. It was the only time that weekend I was shouting, "Come on, Chelsea!" with any vigour. She was very good. She stopped probably another couple of goals. She's really getting into that role now that since we lost Fran at the back. She's doubling up sometimes with Adora, sometimes with Beth. We missed Beth Tat at all. Kirsty was shut down on the wing. It wasn't a great team performance. We had some good individuals, and unfortunately, we weren't the best team on the day, and probably didn't deserve it.
Things to work on.
Yeah, well, we've got probably 2 more encounters against them yet. We're probably going to meet them in the final of one of the cups if things go to plan, and the semi-final of one of the others, so we can put it to rights there and bring home some silverware.
And not on that pitch.
Not on that pitch, definitely. Whatever we're doing.
Brilliant. Nice one. Thanks, Neil, and to you, dear viewer, for watching all this time. It's the moment now you've all been waiting for, the end of the show. So that's Bring Your Own Ball here on FCUM TV for another month. We hope you enjoyed it. Remember, you can watch highlights of matches right now on our website, fcum.tv. A big thank you, as always, to my studio guest, Karl Marginson, who's gone, Roy Williamson, Swampy and Neil Boothman, as I just mentioned, and now gets 2 just for being late. Not forgetting Marv on the stairs or wherever he ended up near the beef burgers, and Kay in Moston. We'll be back at the start of March to bring you all the action from another month of hashtag FCUM hot action classic NPL bants. And in the meantime, do follow us on Twitter, where it's at. That's what Beck was asking on the album Odelay. I know the answer. It's at FCUM TV on Twitter. I'll sit there.